So, is everyone awake? Is everyone awake? Okay, good. Okay, so it's my first time in FOSSMeet, actually in Calicut, but before that I have attended many conferences and have talks and etc. So thank you FOSSMeet for having me here. Okay, so let's get started with talk. Okay. So, okay, first of all, who am I? So, I'm Amol Kahat. I'm working with Red Hat India Private Limited, Pune. So, actually, we are in Pune. We're developing a community, Python community, which is the community we are running from last 3 to 4 years. And again, we are trying to build a more community with other professionals and etc. Okay. After that. I'm open source contributor. I like to contribute into the free so and open source softwares. So like softwares like which are related to the security and etc. So this is how and I also contributing in the Ansible against some Git projects and etc. Lots of things. Okay. After that, I was the organizer in last. If you heard about the DevConf, so how many of heard about the DevConf? Okay. So it was again open source conference, which was again sponsored by the Red Hat. And in this conference, we again have some talks and etc. Which is again conference. This is also one of the nice conference you should guide should attend because you will get to know the lots of things about the technology and you can meet the new peoples inside the conference. Okay. So okay. So this is the overview of the talk. So what we are going to discuss about like certificate types and etc. stuff. Okay. So let's get started. Okay. So this certificate phenomenon is also known as the public infrastructure. Okay. Which is known as the PKI. So how many of you have laptops and how many of you have internet connection with it or Jio will work? Okay. It means most of them have it, right? So go and Google it. Thank you. Thank you for having me here. Okay. Okay. So actually, what is the certificates? So certificates are nothing but the small files, okay, with some random text. You don't know what that text is. After some analysis, you know. Okay. So what that file include? It includes some version, serial, subject, and issuer. Okay. Validity, users, key type, and signing algorithms. Etc. Okay, so that certificates are nothing but some random numbers. Okay, if you've seen it into the some perspective and etc. So Base64 encoded format, so you will see like just some random text. That's it. Okay, so have you heard about the HTTP and HTTPS? Right. So what is the difference between HTTP and HTTPS? Okay. So first difference you guys could say that like okay, is HTTP is just not secure, but HTTPS is a secure. Okay, so that's yes, and that HTTPS stands for security, right? Or secure. Okay, so what made that protocol to its HTTPS? Okay, so these are these SSL certificates. Okay, so let's see how these certificates are generated and how these certificates are working. Okay. So first of all, let's go with little bit certificate types. Okay, so there are three types of certificates. Okay, and there are lots of types of certificate. You can generate it lots of types. Okay. So first of all, self-sign certificates. Any idea what is self-sign? Okay, means I am authorizing myself. That I am a one community. Okay, so this type of certificates like issued by the some of the known certificate authorities and etc. which are hosted somewhere else on the globe. Okay, so these certificates are say that this is the self-signer certificate and they are saying that I am an authority and I'm going to issue you some certificates. Okay, so after that okay, I will show you the demo about it. Okay, so extended validation certificates. Okay, so have you been on twitter.com? Okay, so let's go to the twitter.com. Okay, so here, okay, it's not visible up there, but okay, here you can see that it's completely green. Okay, and if you go to the google.com, so it shows like HTTPS. Okay, so it says here HTTPS, and here it says Twitter Inc. Okay, so that Twitter Inc. is nothing but your extended validation certificates. Those certificates are issued after the all of your background checks. Means your company is visible, you have your company, it's located where your etc. all legal formalities they're done, and after that they issue these certificates. Okay, but if you see in the third type, okay, so that third type is nothing but HTTPS. So this is just server certificate. Okay, so and here green lock indicate that this connection is secure and the certificate is included, and which is the valid certificate. Okay, so after that, okay, one of the most interesting topic. So how you guys know about, how many of you know about these two types of security, means cryptography types? Okay, so everyone should know that, because from ancient times we are using this. If you heard about if you heard about the history and etc., so that time our people, means who are our ancestors, they were using some random text to send to somewhere, so our enemies could not read. Even if in the World War we used that, right? If you saw in the some movies, fiction on based on that, so you guys know that. Okay, so there are two types of cryptography. First one is the asymmetric cryptography. Second one is the symmetric cryptography. Okay, so is it really possible? Two keys to, okay, so let's discuss first about symmetric. So how you log into any website? How you log into any website? You can directly put your email plus your password. Okay, at the end that password got checked. You are provided the correct password or not. Okay. Only and only this password, when you provide it, that time your account will be unlocked. Okay, so this is also known as the symmetric cryptography, or best example of the symmetric cryptography. Suppose I encrypted one message using one key, and this key is want to decrypt this message. So what that time, what can I do? So that time, what I do, I will just encrypt it with some algorithm, and I will give one some key for that. Okay, after the giving the key, that message is completely into the random. I seriously don't know what kind of that message is. Okay, so this is also known as the symmetric cryptography. Okay, after that, asymmetric. What is meant by asymmetric? Any idea? Sorry? Okay. Okay, so there are two keys. One is the public key, one is the private key. Okay. So public key also stands for, means these keys you can generate using some tools and etc. So first thing about the public key is like, it's available everywhere. Means you can host that key to the server, and anyone can take this key. Okay. And second one is the private key. The private key is have only and only you have that private key in your computer. Okay. Until and unless your permission, no one using it. Okay. So how this cryptography work? Okay. So let's talk about, suppose I'm unknown person on the internet. Suppose I want to send some encrypted or some confidential message to some person. Okay. That time what I do? What I do, I will take his public key, encrypt my message with his public key. The guy who have the same whose public key is belonging and same associated key with private key that guy have, so only and only that can guy decrypt the key. Decrypt the message, sorry. Okay, so this is how these things work. So this is really quite a hard process. If you attended the yesterday's talk about Amarjit, so he was telling like, if you start it with early, then you are end up with early. Okay. When the internet was started that time, they never thought it will be going to grow like this, which we have today. Okay, so currently we have internet. After that, we have lots of darknet. Okay, I think you guys are familiar with darknet. Okay, just go and Google it. Okay, so when the internet started that time, only we have HTTP protocol. They just started with that HTTP protocol just for communication and between two machines and et cetera, okay? But actually what happened? This thing grows. People are started using it. Lots of companies and et cetera, they are started using it. So they need to patch it. They need to provide some security for that. Because if people are using it, then they need to transfer some data to the some server and et cetera, so that time it's really insecure to transfer it on HTTP. Okay, if you really want to see, go and hack some sites. You have Kali Linux and et cetera tools, and you can use some tools to hack into some sites and et cetera. Go, you can run 1, 2, 3, 4 commands, and you will be able to get the password which you are trying to use for that provider, that site, and you can able to print that password on your terminal. Okay, so this is but that security is not sufficient for means people like us who anyone can access it, go to the login again and modify our data and etc. Okay, so what they have done, they provided some security. So they came out with the SSL certificates idea. Okay, so these SSL certificates are X509 standard certificate. Okay, these certificates are really complex. Even if we'll go in detail, I will go into explain one by one. Okay, so these certificates need some authority, some etc. for that. So after that, they can start with building something like this, and it provides some secure connection. Okay, so how you think how this connection works? Okay, so let me explain it. Suppose you have you are opening like google.com. So between that, what happened? Client send some request to the Google. Okay, it's completely about the web web networking and et cetera, okay? So what happened? Client sent some request to the server, and after that server was responded with its certificate and et cetera. Okay, and after that they are saying, okay, now we are going to have a communication using some encrypted keys or encrypted messages. Okay, so your connection from your machine to the server is completely got encrypted. Even the middle people also don't know what they are trying to communicate. Okay, but there are some loopholes, drawbacks, and etc. So using that, you got exposed. Okay, so what exactly is process? How to generate the certificate and etc. Okay, if you want to generate the certificate, so first of all, you need to have one CA authority. So how many of you heard about the Let's Encrypt? Okay, so lots of people know about the Let's Encrypt. Okay, so Let's Encrypt is nothing but the one certificate authority. Okay, which is written in Go, and it's again powerful using some, it will provide you some free certificates. And after the free certificate, it has some CLI interface and etc. Using that, you can request for the certificates. Okay, so there is another lots of certificate authority, like Microsoft have their certificate authority. After that, Symantec, again DigiCert is there. Again, there are lots of certificate authorities are there. Okay, so if you want to do the certificate request, how you are going to do it? So there are some CLIs or using OpenSSL tool. So using that, actually you can make a certificate request and submit it to the CA. CA means certificate authority, which you have all of the track of the what you can do, what you cannot do, and it means certificate about the certificate. What permission I need to give you, what permission I don't give you, kind of, okay? So after that, what certificate authority does? Actually, certificate authority have the permission to cancel your request, approve your request, and so modify your subject name, UID. Suppose you are expecting to have public key or certificate for your domain like www.myhost.com. So if you are providing that subject's common name to a myhost.com, so that means certificate authority also that can modify it. Okay, I'm not sure about the all certificate, but I'm using DocTech certificate system, so which is also internally inside the Red Hat, we known as the Red Hat certificate system. So that I have the installed in VM, so I'm going to show you demo with it. Okay, okay, have permission, oh sorry. Having the permission to modify validity. Suppose user was expecting to, you should provide validity for this certificate for like 3 or 4 years or etc., which is also not possible. So certificate authority have the permission to modify that validity. Okay, can sign the certificate request. Certificate authority can sign the certificate request and give it back to the, okay, add uses and policies. Okay. Okay, if certificate authority going to issue some certificate to you, what exactly policies you are expecting? Okay, means using that certificate, you can actually encrypt the email, you can encrypt the your secure connection, etc., etc., a lot of policies. Okay, can signature and see add signature and issue the certificate at the end. Okay, so after that, okay. So currently, so this is pkiexample.com, this is my VM. I'm not, okay, so this is the HTTPS pkiexample.com. Okay, so when I hit that, so that time it says that your connection is not secure. Okay, because that CA certificate, I hosted that CA, and that CA certificate is not present in your browser. Okay. So if you know about, then inside your browser, there is one privacy and security. Inside, at the end, there is something known as the certificates. Okay. If you open that certificate, there is one tab servers. Okay. That there are all of the CA certificates are listed. Okay. All of these certificates are part of the, means these are the public certificates and you can install that certificates. Okay, after what installing these certificates, what exactly going to do? Means suppose any CA authority if issues the certificate, so browser first checks that this certificate is valid with some CA authority. If it's not valid, then it will show error like this. Your connection is not secure. Means browser don't know or browser do not trust the CA. Which CA is this and what should I do with it? Okay, so I'm ready to taking the risk and I will say add exception. Okay, so it will some prompt some etc. etc. Okay, so this is the certificate authority. Okay, and inside that there are two pages like SSL end user services and agent services. Okay, so I'll go to the agent service. Oh, sorry. I did not provide it the server certificate, admin certificate. Okay, so, but inside the certificate authority, just wait. Okay, so you could see that there are lots of profiles. At the left side, those profiles are listed. Those profiles are nothing but what you can, what type of certificate you want. Okay. So for any user and etc., if I want some certificate, so that time I use this profile. Okay, if I want to encrypt some mail, so use either SMIME profile. Okay, so using these profiles, I can request for the certificate. Okay, so let's show you some actual working example. Okay, so consider from here I'm enrolling some certificates. Okay, so currently I want RSA certificate and suppose I say test user 1001, test user 1001, meetup.example.com and I will just submit it. Okay. So after submitting, it said that your request ID 242. Okay. Means I submitted the request successfully. Now it got submitted and I need to approve that certificate. Means CA, certificate authority, who are the admin and agent, that person need to approve the request. Okay. So first of all, let me export the certificate or copy it. Okay, oh, sorry. Okay, is it visible till back? Okay, so actually I'm copying the certificate from my VM to my host machine. Oops. So this is the directory where the CA certificate is stored. Okay, and I'm copying it to the download directory. Okay, and it got copied. So what can I do? I will add the certificate to my browser. Your certificate, import, and I'm importing the certificate. CAdmincert.p12. You need to provide some password. Okay, so that certificate got imported. So what can I do now? I will go here and it's agent page. So if I refresh it, so it will prompt me for certificate. This is the certificate which you want to use. Okay, so I will say yes, this is the certificate which I want to use. So now you can see that after adding the certificate, it's showing me the contents of the on the web pages. Okay, so I just say list request. And I will just say find all the requests, whatever the requests are there. Okay, so there are lots of, what was the request number for that? It's 242. Okay, so this is the 242, no, it's admin user. Where is the my, oops. I couldn't see the request. Why? Okay. Okay, I'm not sure why it's not showing. Okay, what can I do? Lower serial number 242. Find it. Okay, so I got this as a. Is it admin user or test user 101? Okay, forget it. Okay, so what can we do? Still, I'll show you. Okay, I lost the certificate request somewhere. Okay, so. Sorry. I went to some another tab. Okay, so, okay, see, at the bottom, you could see that the test user 1001, my request got. Means CA have that request you are not. So, what you can do, you can just click here. Oops. Okay, so here, actually, you can modify the UID or CN, just like I told you. So if you want, you can change it like 1001 to, what can I do? Just simple, 11, test user 111. Okay, so after that, you can change the validity. If user requested for like 4 or 6 here, which is not possible, so I can change that. Okay, and this is the key which he provided. Okay, after that, so how the criticality of the subject and etc. So you can, if you are issuing the certificate, then that time this kind of OCSP URI is going to add inside it. Okay, and so these are the criticality, digital signature and etc. This is what the certificate policies which you are going to add inside the certificate. Okay, and after that, so signing algorithm. So using which algorithm I'm going to sign this certificate. Okay, so like just like I told you, like you can do lots of operation with this and you can do and after that submit it. Okay, so once you submit the request, your request got approved. Okay, and this is how the certificate got generated. Okay, so like I told you, it have the version. Is it visible? Kind of otherwise. I think it's visible till the end. No? Okay. Okay, I can go further. Okay, so this is our version V3. This is the SSL version V3. Okay, so this is the serial number which is associated with CA, and using signature, which signature algorithm it, that certificate authority used to sign the certificate. Okay, and after that it have validity. Means Saturday, February 16, before, means even if the, on February 15, if you change the system date and you are trying to using the certificate before the February 15, it, you cannot use that certificate. Okay, and after the August 15, 2019, after that, not even for a single day you are not able to using that certificate. Okay, so after that, this is the certificate authority, CA signing certificate. Okay, means I just named it like this, CA signing certificate. Okay, otherwise I can put my company name, etc., like DigiCert, Twitter, no, not Twitter, like Let's Encrypt and etc., whatever name I want to put, I can put it here. Okay, and after that, these are the modules inside the public key. Okay. Okay. After that, authority info access. Here you could see the one OCSP URI. Okay. So if I'm using any site certificate, then how do I know that this certificate is valid or etc.? Okay. For that, what can I do? I can pick up that OCSP URI from the certificate and show it. Ask that OCSP server, is it certificate validated? Is this certificate still valid or not? So after that, it shows some like, this is the validate, this is revoked, this is expired, or etc. Okay, and okay, this is how this certificate look. So this is the Base64 encoded format, and this certificate format is there are other formats, okay, where the keys can be generated, but as to transfer it on the webs and etc. So we use this Base64 encoded format. Okay, and this is the end of the certificate. If we see our request now, okay, it's gone because of this messy URI. Okay. Okay. So is it clear how to generate certificate and how it's getting, okay. To generate certificate, there are another things, like using two algorithms you can generate the certificate. First one is the RSA and second one is the elliptic curve. Okay, so to generate the certificate, first of all you need some prime numbers and etc. to generate the, if you learn about the RSA algorithm, then RSA algorithm stands on the some RSA some random numbers and etc. After that they compute some logic and etc. and then they go for the generating the public key and private key. Okay, so before that, so how to generate the random numbers? I will just open Python console, import random and random.randint. I want random number from 0 to some large variable. Okay, so every time it will give me some random numbers. Oops. Okay, so these are the random numbers. But do you guys still think that this kind of generation have a backdoor? Okay, so this is how the backdoor. If you are generating these random numbers, then you can predict the random numbers actual how they are getting generated. Okay, if you want to read about it, then go to the Wikipedia and sudo. Wikipedia. Okay, so on pseudo random generator number, if you go down, then it will say that okay, there is one backdoor inside this. Okay. Okay. It has been shown that likely that NSA has interest in symmetric backdoor into the NSA certificate pseudo random number generator dual EC debug. Means there are lots of other articles which will show that how the random numbers are predictable and etc. Okay, so this is the how that random number means for the random number state, once you can predict, so that again you can able to generate the same random numbers on your system. Okay. After that, okay, let's go with next. Okay, so KRA. So recently there was news. Our government issued one statement to the all of the 10 government companies. Is it about 10 government companies can decrypt the data? Have you anyone heard about it? It's Indian government, not NSA or etc. It's Indian government. Okay, so I'll tell you the story. So these companies are trying to decrypt the data which you are trying to communicate between any sites and etc. Okay, if you are trying to open some torrent sites and etc. from your browser, then you will get one notification that this is site blocked by your government. Okay, so how they are going to decrypt your data if they don't have their private key? So actually, there is another type of key request which is also known as the key archival request. Okay, means the server or certificates, if they want to archive their request, then they submit this request which is in the kind of form where the you can archive your private key inside the certificate authority, and that certificate authority store your key inside the KRA. Okay, so that KRA is nothing but key recovery authority, means it stores all of your keys with related to the certificates. Okay, and using that key you can retrieve that key and use to decrypt the data. Okay, so this is how these things works. Okay, just like I mentioned that you can see one OCSP URI inside the certificate. Okay, just let me show PKI-P200-CA-CERT-01-PRET. Okay, so this is the self-signed certificate. Okay, because why it's self-signed? Because its issuer and subject are both are the same. CA signing certificate, CA signing certificate. Okay, and what was I telling you? Okay, OCSP, yeah. Okay, if you go down and see here, there is one OCSP URI. So it go and check for the certificate for this URI. Because every time I go with the server, then that server is not able to handle all of the requests. So that's why what can I do? I will another start one system which is known as the online certificate status protocol. So if I want to check the certificate status, then I will go to that OCSP server instead of going with the CA. Okay, and this how the OCSP getting know that the CA is means certificate is revoked, expired or compromised? So that time what happens, CA what can do, CA push some CRL, means certification revocation list. It will push the expired certificate, revoked certificate list to the OCSP at some scheduled time. Okay, so using that OCSP get to know that, okay, this is the how things happening. Means these certificates are revoked. If for particular certificate serial number, if the request came to me, then what can I do? I'll just say that this certificate is revoked or this certificate is expired. Okay. Okay. Okay, so actually let's see the working. So how many of you know the TLS 1.2? Okay, only one guy? Two guys? Okay, so this is the everyday protocol which you are using in your life. Okay, so this is nothing but the transport layer security protocol. Okay, when you say the google.com, so that time, just like I told you, like you can send one request, okay, inside the packet format. Oh, so this is the Wireshark, I presume everyone knows about it. And so in that package, client says, I mean my browser says that, okay, I want to connect with you. So for that, I am sending some random data for the key, means secret competition, master secret competition, etc. Okay, so these are the algorithms or languages, encrypted communication languages, where I can speak with you. Okay, so these are the TLS, ECDSA, ECDSA. Okay, if I'm talking about this protocol, TLS, ECDSA, ECDSA with AES 128, GCM, SHA-256, which is very mouthful. Okay, so what actually it stands for? Any idea? Okay, TLS, again, it's protocol. ECDSE, ECDSA, which is used for the, ECDHE, which is stands for that elliptic curve Diffie-Hellman key exchange. Okay, so for that key exchange, that if you, protocol, first part of protocol, which is elliptic curve wall, protocol will use. ECDSA with AES-128 GCM, this protocol is used for sharing your keys. Okay, and after that, SHA-256, this protocol is, sorry, this algorithm is used for check the message authentication, or MAC. Okay, have you know about the MAC? SHA-SUM, have you ever downloaded the software or any OS from server? Yes, so you could see one SHA-1, SHA-256, SHA-512 sum there. Right, or not? So that SHA-SUM is nothing but this SHA-SUM. Okay, so after that, when that packet reached to the server side, that time server says, server hello, and after that, with it, it sent the certificate, key extend means it sent the certificate again, it sent the public key, okay, and again server hello done means he says that okay, I'm done with the hello and etc. Okay, so let's talk about some one particular protocol using one particular protocol. Where is that? Okay, sorry, it's in the server hello. Okay, so it says that okay, let's talk about with this protocol, because I think it's secure and these protocols are configured in my server. Okay, so after that, client key exchange. Okay, so after that, what happened? Client generate one symmetric key. Okay, after the generating the symmetric key, it encrypt the next message with that symmetric key, and it will encrypt that symmetric key with server's public key and send it to the server. So from now onwards, what can do server and client encrypt with, communicate with each other using that shared symmetric key. Okay, so this is how this TLS 1.2 protocol happens. And again, in TLS 1.3, there are lots of changes. It's just got again. Okay, just like I told, like, okay, change the cipher specs and let's stack, talk about some encrypted keys and etc. Okay. Okay, so that was the demo, like Wireshark. Okay. Okay. So if there is one CA authority, then why I need some sub CAs? Okay, so CA sub CAs are nothing but the same, the working like a same like a CA, etc., but their certificate is issued by the root CA. Okay, suppose I'm let's encrypt issuing some certificate means if you go and see its certificate, so it's a self-signed certificate, and that again DigiCert have lots of other sub CAs. Okay, so you could go and see that if you see in the certificate and etc. Okay, I'll show you after that, and there are lots of sub CAs which are configured below that. Okay, why we need to configure that certificates or sub CAs? Okay, if my root authority's keys got compromised, or if someone hacked into the that machine and stole the public key, private key, then all of the connection which using that certificate authority, all connections are got compromised. I'm able to decrypt each and everyone's data using that public key, private key. Okay, so what people do, they store all of their keys inside one server, they issue one sub CA. And after issuing the sub CA, what they can do, they permanently offline that machine. If they want to issue some sub CAs and etc., that time they bring that machine online and just issue it. Till now, they just put it offline. Otherwise, there is another one option, which is known as the hardware security modules. I'm not sure how many of you heard about it. But these are the devices, like some hardware devices. Using that, you can actually generate some pure secure random numbers, and plus it stores your private key, and either you can delete the private key or add the private key. You cannot export the private key use from that HSM devices. Okay. Okay. Let last, and my time is getting up. It's Okay, so inside the servers, if I say DigiNor, if I say view, okay, so this is the issued to and issued by not digital root CA. Okay, so there is root CA authority and not digital DigiNotr. Okay, so that certificate got issued and this is again contained the same, but it's have some its format and etc. They have some provided UI. Okay, and signature value and etc. Okay, so this is I don't have any certificate. Why? Okay, otherwise if I check the certificate of this secure connection, google.com, and I say more information. So it says that the view certificate and this is Google Nets Internet Authority G3. Okay, so means it's again the sub CA. Okay, and it's issued to the google.com. Means Google have its own CA. Again, that CA issued some sub CA. And for that, and that sub CA issued that google.com certificate to the google.com. Okay. Okay. Okay, so that was the demo, how sub CA works and etc. So, okay, thank you. Any questions? Okay.
So there are a lot of certificate authorities, right?
Sorry?
There are a lot of certificate authorities.
Yeah.
Yeah. So the problem is that how do we know that if NSA or any other organizations hasn't already gotten the private certificates of the CAs? We can't really be sure that everything is encrypted, right? I mean, there is a possibility that maybe the governments already know the certificates. They can just use that and decrypt what we have. I mean, how do we make sure that CAs are actually safe?
So I will suggest go with some open source CA. Like in previous talk, he was like Makanan was mentioning, like if some services are hosted by the community, then you should trust on these communities. Okay, and really, I'm not that kind of guy who would comment on the NSA or etc. Maybe they have some contract, they stole the private key and encrypt your data, etc. No one knows that. Okay, except NSA. Okay, so there is one another thing. So if you really want to maintain your privacy, etc., so you can use your GPG keys and etc. for connection. Otherwise, you can go with the Tor browser, which is currently market in the very boom market. Okay. So that's it. So no one comments about it. And okay, so I don't want to comment it, but just understand that security is just myth. Okay, Google know each and every one about details about you. What you can do when you wake up, when you go to sleep, and etc. Even if I'm talking to you, so that phone is inside my pocket, which is the Android device, which is synced with the gmail.com, and okay, I know that he's capturing my voice and he's sending to the google.com for make his product good, Google Home Services, etc. Okay, any other questions?
Just like one question. So, random number generation is there, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, so that's basically like pseudo random number generation as well as the true random number generation. So the true random number generation, in which we take the real world noise into like the digital world. So like, are there possibilities that that can be, that is also like not completely fail safe? Like someone can break into that? Because currently most of the, as far as I know, most of the attacks are based on vulnerabilities and not like cryptographic attacks.
Yeah.
Cryptographic attacks are very rare in nature. And especially something driven by the random number, like that particular fact, from what I read, is very low.
Mm.
So is it possible like to use that as a mechanism for, like once we know the random number, like is it possible to attack? Like does that system become vulnerable?
So once you got the, what kind of random number or
like that pattern, like for instance, generally very true randomness is used, like from what I know, in like scientific applications, like for modeling of gas molecules. So they use like radium and all that to cap like the spontaneity of the radiation to capture the randomness, and that randomness will be used for the parameters of a particular equation. So there it needs to be completely random so that it will not be replicated.
But if I talked to you correctly, then if you are saying like gas molecules and etc. So at the some stage, it's also kind of predictable.
No, like.
So currently we have some flaws in atomic clock. Then how we can say that this is also kind of secure? But again, this is a one worth for try. Okay, so till now for random generation and etc. We have some HSM devices which directly generate the hardware. Random numbers using the hardware and etc.
Yeah, so like if it's there and right then the chip, like Intel and all, they have some engineers or something which gives that for random, right?
Yeah.
So if the hardware vendors know what it is there, so like again, it's like.
So first of all, how the random numbers are computed? Okay, so what you can do, they some pick up some data from your system and etc. Using that, they generate the random numbers with some operations and etc. And with some their number, computed mathematical logics. Right, so this is how the random numbers are generated. So in hardware also, they have implemented also the same thing. They on the RAM, inside RAM, you don't know what kind of data you have, etc. Okay, once that random number got generated, they apply some algorithms and etc. With like, if you studied about the AES 256 and etc. So what they can do, they can just go over XORing until 256 times. Okay, so this is the how these things works. Okay, thanks.